Levites, the priests, and the musicians came together as one in the temple. They made a glorious sound before the Lord, and the presence of the Almighty filled the sanctuary. Break out the cymbals and tambourines. Call out the trumpets and horns.
Fire, you reign, yes. Forever. goodness knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. And I'll sing, come on. And I'll sing because you are good. And I'll dance because you are good. And I'll shout because you are good.
You are good.
suffering, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good. You are so good. You are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath.
It's your breath. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you, all. like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Makes us whole, and you shoulder weakness, and your strength becomes our own. And you're making me like you, you're clothing me in white, bringing beauty for ashes. For you will have your bride free of all her guilt and rid of all her shame.
You are worthy.
on, sing a melody of praise to the Lord. Your own song from your heart. I offer up a song of praise from my heart to you. Oh Lord, I bring you more than a song. I bring you more than a song, Jesus. I offer up my heart to you.
Father, we thank you this morning for your awesome presence, and we acknowledge you are here, and we want to hear from you today. Refreshed us, Lord. Refreshed us, we pray. In Jesus' name, and we say amen. Amen. We may sit down. I'm glad to be here this morning. Praise God. Somebody paid for my fare to come home because it's my wife's birthday, you know. I'm supposed to come on December for the Christmas. But somebody from our team in the Philippines said, you know, Pastor, I'll pay for your fare and go home for Ate Ida's birthday. So it's Sister Ida's birthday today. So let's appreciate her. You know, my wife, I will not be where the Lord has taken me this far in my walk, without my wife. I met her in the university many, many years ago. That's 1979. And never did I imagine that, the Lord will give me a life, a family, and serving Him. Because my life then was really troubled, and it's broken, totally broken. And praise God, Jesus makes us whole. Amen. So don't be despondent, amen? That's a new word I've heard lately, and I look at the meaning, despondent, to be hopeless, to be discouraged, to be oppressed, distressed. But I told the person who said that, there's despondency. I said, yes, there may be despondency in the world, but let me tell you, our God is a living God. God is in control. We live in a broken world. We live in a world that is full of injustice, and we cannot do anything about that. We just have to make a choice to live for God daily. We have to make a choice. It's intentional. That's why I encourage you, start your day always in prayer. Start your day with the Lord. Let's live a life of worship. Amen. Worship is more than having music like this. We have our worship team because they lead us to sing and to encourage us to worship God in spirit and in truth. But worship is from the heart. Amen. And worship is a lifestyle. That's why we here in Agape, we declare from the start that we are a worshiping people. And worship is more than just being on here on Sunday. Worship is every day. We worship God every day. The work we have, amen? Or maybe you're a student, even your studies is a worship to the Lord. It's everything we do unto the Lord. And I thank God that we are learning that. Some of us have learned it much deeper. Others are just beginning. But I want to remind us that we here in this congregation, our heart's desire is to be worshipers of the living God. Amen? And we are a praying church. We believe in prayer. I believe in prayer. Do you believe in prayer? When all else fails, sometimes we try to do things, we manipulate, but let me tell you, here we believe prayer first. Because prayer, we say, we need God. When we pray, we say, I need you, God. When we don't pray, we're saying, I don't need God. But here, we teach here that we need God. How many here need God this morning? That's why we pray. And we are a loving church. You may not know the person sitting right beside you right now. Do you know their name? I hope you get to know their name. That's one way of loving them. Get to know their name. You know this. Sometimes the sweetest name second to Jesus is the name of the is your name, all right? Can you get to know the name of the person beside you? Say, what's your name if you don't know their name? And say, I love you with the love of the Lord. We are a loving church. And let's learn. Let's learn to love one another by carrying one another's burden. Amen. Some of you are smiling right now, but I know there are pain in your heart. You're struggling. But let me tell you, when someone just holds you, just, isn't it? I believe, you know, my shaking of hands every time I come, my smile. You know, I pray that God will use my smile. I come from the land of smiles, the Philippines. We are a loving church. To love is to give more than to get. Are you with me? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. That's the greatest love. No, to give His life. He gave His life for us. And we are a mission church. That's why for the past 4 years now, you have released me as your senior pastor. I've been doing missions. We've been pioneering work in the States and in the Philippines and trying to reach other nations, because I believe it should be more than just these four walls. Amen. God has given us these three buildings and we have the school. There's so many challenges we face right now financially, with situations change. You know, but let me tell you, the God who brought us this far, this church is over 30 years, right? We started in 1986, so that's about 31 years, right? So the God who brought us from Bayswater to Stratford, now to Manor Park, is the same God that we still serve. He never failed us, and He will not start now. And this is what I would like to remind us today. That's why I'm entitled God's message this morning as God's track record. Are you still there? God's track record. I don't know if you could make it a thing for me there. And the thing, I didn't give you my PowerPoint, but don't worry, we have the power. Even though there's no PowerPoint there, no? God's track record. And I would like to use Numbers 14 and Deuteronomy chapter 1. I look at the definition of track record. It means a record of past performance often taken as an indicator. Say it with me, indicator. Yes. An indicator of likely future performance. And this morning, I would like to bring to us God's track record. He is a great God. You know, His past performance in our lives. How many of you can look back and say that God is good in your life? His performance in my life from 1979. That's the time I have an encounter with God. I have received Him as my Lord and my Savior, you know, right there in our living room in the Philippines. To this day, 2017, from 1979 to 2017, that's how many years? 37 years. I would like to declare to us how great is our God. He is a great God, and we need to experience this. More than being declared to you, more than just hearing it, you must know Him. And there must be a progressive knowing. And you know what? He will not fail you. If we will walk with Him, let me tell you, He will walk with us. Don't leave Him. Amen. I was just preaching this past three Sundays in the Philippines. the messages of the Lord to the churches in Asia and the book of Revelation, and the message of the Lord to the church at Ephesus is this: you have left your first love. Okay, living is different from losing. Before, I thought we lose our first love. No, we don't lose our first love. We don't lose it. To lose something is you don't know. And when you lose something, you don't know where to find it. Are you with me? But when, if you look at Revelation chapter 2, the message of the Lord to the church of Ephesus is this: you left. This is what I have against you. You left your first love. Yes, I know your labor. I know your works. I know your doctrine is pure. He said it's a active church, the church at Ephesus. But there's one thing the Lord said to the church at Ephesus: you left. To live is intentional. You have a discretion, right? They left their first love. And I have to tell you, from 1979 to 2017, there are moments in my life, okay, I have to be very, very honest. There are seasons in my walk with the Lord that I left my first love. And that's why, you know, I lost the vitality. I lost the passion. Hello, are you still there? I don't know if you've experienced that, but I've experienced it. But that's why every time I look into the Word, the Lord uses His Word to bring me back. And it's a decision to go back to our first love. You can be busy doing things. You could be doing ministry. You could be doing this, doing that. But let me tell you, to love the Lord, one thing is needful, the Lord said to Martha. How many of you know these sisters in the Bible? Mary and Martha. You know, Martha was so busy serving, and then she saw her sister Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus when Jesus was there, and she was just listening. And Martha said to the Lord Jesus, "Lord, don't you care my sister? You know, she's just sitting there. Tell her to help me." Oh, the Lord said to Martha, "Martha, Martha, you are busy with many things. One thing is needful." Listen. It's not activity. The Christian activity, that's what the Lord requires of us. Look at me. It's your love. And He said, go back to the first works. You know what are the first works? When I first came to know the Lord, what are the first works I did? I read the Bible. And every time I read the Bible, let me tell you, my first Bible is a red Bible, small one, by the Gideon. Every time I read the Gospel, I finish the Gospels reading, tears are just pouring on the pages of my Bible. I love the Word. How many still love the Word? If you don't love the Word, let me tell you, you have left your first love. I love the Word, and I love the Lord. During those times, I have my appointment with the Lord every day. He comes first. But there are times in my life, do you still have appointment alone with the Lord today? Alone, and not only on Sunday. One-on-one with the Lord. Listen, in these last days, we need it. It's our time with the Lord every day that will sustain us till He comes back. How many of you believe that Jesus is coming back? We don't know when, but we know it's soon. Listen, today I'm so concerned with, you know, I've traveled, I've seen churches, I've seen big churches, small churches, I've seen Christians. But you know what? It's not the numbers that matters in a church. As your senior pastor, I want to remind us that what is really important is your personal relationship with God. Amen. And so, you know, the track record of the God or the Lord in my life, I could say, Lord, He has been faithful. Though I have failed Him at times, let me tell you, He does not fail me. Every time I go back, He's there. How many of you know that? You may fail the Lord, but let me tell you, every time we come back to Him, He doesn't reject. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. When I lose that passion, I don't want to lose this passion, you know. I'm as in love. Just like in 1979, in fact, even more, I believe. I love Him. In fact, my favorite song, me and Sister Ida, they're asking us, what is your theme song? Theme song. Usually you have theme song like love song, no? But I think our theme song is this. I keep falling in love with Him over and over and over and over again. I don't know how many of you know this song, you know? This is a song during the charismatic movement in the Philippines in the 70s. I keep falling in love with Him. And I would like to tell you today, I this is true to me. I would like to say to you and to Him, I keep falling in love with you, Jesus, over and over again. And I can sing this to my wife. It's her birthday today, you know. But what I'm trying to say, this God, our God, my God, your God, He is a good God. He has a good track record. The indication that He, you know, He has been true in the past and He will be true today and the future. In Numbers chapter 14, open your Bible with me very quickly here. We will read this. God brought out the people of Israel, you know, and promised them to bring them to a place that is flowing with milk and honey. It's the promised land. And for about a year from coming out of Egypt, okay, through signs and wonders, the Lord showed to them how He delivered them out from the hands of Pharaoh. And then they have crossed the Red Sea. How many of you have seen the movie Ten Commandments? Although not everything there is biblical, but it shows to us dramatically how they were delivered from slavery, okay, and then they crossed the Red Sea. And then we know that as they travel, you know, God provided for them every day the food that they need to eat. God gave them manna, heavenly bread, every day. God gave them water in the desert. And then when they desire meat, God sent what? Quails. And the Bible tells us that as they travel in the wilderness, you know, there is a pillar of cloud like an umbrella. When it's hot like this in the Philippines, you know, I've been in the Philippines now for over a year. You know, you see umbrellas when it's hot. The Filipinos, they don't want to get dark. Yeah? They use umbrella. Because the heat, it really hurts your skin. Could you imagine in the desert? How many of you been in the desert? In the Middle East, I've been in Bahrain. I spoke one time in a fellowship there, and it's really hot. To walk with the sun up, it's hot. So you need an umbrella. Do you know God used a pillar of cloud to cover them as they travel? Over 600,000 men. Except women and children. So they believe it's about maybe a million people. They are being covered by the pillar of cloud like an umbrella. And at night, because it's very dark, there's no London electricity. Hello? There's no electricity in the wilderness. And so God, there's a pillar of fire. Because it's also cold in the wilderness. And for about a year, God has been so faithful to them, providing for them. And now they are at the threshold of entering the promised land. Are you still with me? And so, you know, as they are about to enter, the Lord promised them already, this is the land that I promised you. Moses said, go and enter in. Do you know what the people of Israel, the leaders, because Moses assigned leaders, he said, look, let's send out spies first. Let's look out the land first. Are you still there? They have been in the wilderness for over a year now. They have experienced the provisions of the Lord. They have seen signs and wonders by God from the time they went out of Egypt. They have the promise of God that they will come to a land flowing with milk and honey. And it's now right before them. And what did they do? What did they do? Well, just like you and me, we use our coconut, we call it. We use our intelligence. They want to strategize. Look at there. And so Moses sent them to spy out the land, verse 17, and said to them, okay, go up this way into the south, go up to the mountains, see what the land is like, verse 18. I'm on Numbers 13. I'm sorry, no? Not on 14 yet. Numbers 13 muna. Look, see what the land is like, whether the people who dwell in it are strong or weak, few or many, whether the land they dwell in is good or bad, whether the cities they inhabit are like camps or strongholds, whether the land is rich or poor, whether there are forests there or not. Be of good courage. Bring some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the season of the first ripe grapes. And so they went up and spied out the land from the wilderness of Sin as far as Rehob, near the entrance of Hamath. And they went up through the south and came to Hebron. Ahiman, Sheshai, and Talmai, the descendants of Anak, were there. These are the giants, no? Now Hebron was built 7 years before Zoan in Egypt. Then they came to the valley of Eshcol, and there cut down a branch with one cluster of grapes. One cluster of grapes. They carried it between two of them in a pole. Could you imagine how big are these grapes? Yesterday, my wife bought a cluster of grapes, and we were eating it together sweetly. That's the truth. They're all this big. But this grape, a cluster, two person must carry it. So imagine how big are those grapes. Huh? And so they carried it on a pole. And they also brought some of the pomegranates and figs. Figs. The place was called the Valley of Eshcol because of the cluster which the men of Israel cut down there. And they returned from spying out of the land after 40 days. Now, they departed and came to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. They brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. Verse 27. Then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey. And this is its fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwell there, okay, verse 28, it starts with this word, nevertheless. Okay, they said, well, the land really is, wow. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, and this is the fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are what? Strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. These are the giants, no? Maybe they're really tall. The Amalekites dwell in the land in the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of Jordan. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses, verse 30. and said, "Let us go up at once, take possession, for we are well able to overcome it." Verse 31. But the man who had gone up with him said, "We are not able against, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we." Are you following me here? And they gave the children of Israel a what? Is it a good report? No, it's a bad report of the land with which they have spied out, saying, "The land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature." Verse 33, "There we saw the giants, the descendants of Anak came from the giants, and we were like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight." Listen, God gave them a promise already. And God's track record, okay, God has been with them already for over a year. All right? But here they are, as they're about to enter this promised land, instead of going ahead, you know what? If we will look at Deuteronomy chapter 1, let's go to Deuteronomy. What really happened? I'd like you to see this, because this happens to us today. Deuteronomy chapter 1, beginning on verse 19. "So we departed from Horeb and went through all that great and terrible wilderness which you saw on the way to the mountains of the Amorites, as the Lord our God had commanded us. Then we came to Kadesh Barnea. And I said to you, 'You had come to the mountains of the Amorites, which the Lord our God is giving us. Look, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up, possess it, as the Lord God of your fathers has spoken to you. Do not fear or be discouraged.'" Verse 22, look at this. Underline this in your Bible. Verse 22. "And every one of you came near to me and said, 'Let us send men before us and let them search out the land for us and bring back word to us of the way by which we should go up and of the cities into which we shall come.'" Verse 23. Look at this. Underline this too. "The plan pleased me well. So I took 12 of your men, one from each tribe. And they departed and went up into the mountains and came to the valley of Eshcol and spied out. They also took some of the fruit of the land in their hands and brought it down to us, and they brought it back. They brought back word to us, saying, 'It is a good land in which the Lord our God is giving us.'" Verse 26, underline this. "Nevertheless, you would not go up, but rebelled against the command of the Lord your God." Verse 27, "You complain in your tents and said, 'Because the Lord hates us, he has brought us out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us.'" Verse 28, "Where can we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, 'The people are greater and taller than we. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven.'" Look at the exaggeration. "Moreover, we have seen the sons of the Anakim there. Then I say to you, do not be terrified or afraid of them. The Lord your God who goes before you, he will fight for you according to all he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. And in the wilderness where you saw how the Lord your God carried you as a man carries his son in all the way that you went until you came to this place. Yet for all that, you did not believe the Lord your God, who went in the way before you to search out a place for you to pitch your tents, to show you the way you should go." This is it. "In the fire by night and in the cloud by day." What is Moses saying here? He's rehearsing. He's repeating to the Israelites. This is what happened in Kadesh Barnea. After 1 year of traveling, now they're about to enter the promised land. And instead of going ahead, moving forward, you know what they did? Instead of going forward in faith, trusting God's promise to them, they had a plan. And what is their plan? Send men first. Look at the land and see. Why? Sometimes, you know, instead of us going forward in faith, believing the promise of God for us, how many of you believe that the plan of God for you and for me is a good plan? Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you, plans not for evil, but plans that is to give you future and hope." How many of you believe that your future is good? Sometimes we are afraid of the future. So we would like to strategize for our future. Hello, are you still there? Okay. We occasionally forget what God has done in and through our trials. How many of you have experienced trials in your life before? And God has delivered us out of these trials. Okay, trials, let's say, let's use problems. How many of you had problems before? And your problem from, you had problem in maybe 1970s and up to 2000 now, your problem is still there? The problem is only for a season. If you are a believer, the Lord will maybe allow you to get through that situation, but then the Lord will take you out as well. And so sometimes we occasionally forget everything God has done. Sometimes we struggle with a deep-seated fear of the unknown. How many of you are afraid of the future? I'm afraid of my future. I'm getting old now. I'm turning 62. Huh? Some of you are 69, turning 70. I'm not as strong. My back is aching. What will I do? You know, sometimes we're afraid of our future. I have not saved enough money for my retirement. I don't have enough pounds in my savings. Listen, if we have surrendered our lives to the Lord, we have surrendered everything, including our future. Our plans, our ambitions. So, sometimes we're scared, no? And we experience unnecessary anxiety instead of relying on God's track record. The God who's been there in the past is also the God who is here with us right now, trying to tell you He has a good track record. Our God never fails. So let us walk by faith. Say to the person beside, walk by faith. What does it mean to walk by faith? To live by faith. Habakkuk 2:4 in the Old Testament. He says there, the just shall live by faith. What does it mean? In my study of this verse, it means that we must trust, live by the faithfulness of the promises of God in our lives. How many of you know the promises of God? There are thousands of promises here. That's why we need to read the Word. We need to live by the faithfulness of the promises of God in our lives. If God promised, let me tell you, the Bible tells us, He who promised is faithful. So, sometimes we think that to walk by faith is like taking a risk. That's in our mind. Huh? To walk by faith is taking a risk. You know, when I felt the call of the Lord in my life in 1980, that's barely 1 year Christian, 1 year old Christian, I worked as an accountant in Angeles City. I was preparing to take my board examination. And my boss promised me that I will get rich. He said, we will get rich. Let's work on this business. I will send you to La Salle Business School. In the Philippines, there are good schools there like Ateneo and La Salle in Manila. I said, I will send you to La Salle Business School and we will get rich. If I get rich, you get rich. But you know, I said to my boss, I said, I fulfilled the call of God in my life. I don't even understand it yet. I said, I want to serve God. I want to be a missionary. Where? He said, to China. I've never been. I said, and he doesn't understand. I was very young Christian. I don't know what I'm saying. But you know what? I asked God for a sign if he really is calling me. And God gave me that sign. And I resigned from my job. And Sister Eden knows this. It was not easy because I want to plan for my future. And I resigned from my job and I started serving the Lord. Starting a work in one town in Pampanga, pioneering a work and no salary. No salary. Okay, in Philippines, pastors have no salary during those days in the 80s. And my relatives, they told me, how will you feed your family? How will you, you know, how will you survive without a job? I said, I don't know. But I just know that the Lord will take care of me. It's like taking a risk. Risk, R-I-S-K. And you know what? It's not actually a risk. It's trusting in God's promises. I know it's not easy for some of us if we have not yet experienced the faithfulness of God. But let me tell you, in Deuteronomy chapter 1, Moses is affirming to us the Lord's reliability. The Lord is reliable. Say it with me. The Lord is reliable. Let's go to verse 21. What did he say in verse 21? Look! Deuteronomy 1 verse 21. Look! The Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up, possess it as the Lord our God, the Lord God of your fathers has spoken to you. Do not fear or be discouraged. He is reminding them that God has promised to their forefathers. And he said, he is reliable. He encouraged them. Enjoy your inheritance. Go in now. But did they go in? No, they want a strategy. They want a plan. Sometimes we are like this. Facing the future, we want to be sure. Oh, let me study first. I must do a strategy. You know, they asked me now in the Philippines, what's your strategy to reach out the foreign nationals here in Clark? That's where we started our work. They said, what strategy? Did you have a kind of a business plan? You know, Mr. Ashley is always reminding me, do you have a business plan like what you will do? When we were there on the top floor there, which is now I think there are flats, no? And we were praying to move to this area. He was asking me, how will you renovate? Because these are only box before. I said, I pray. he was waiting for me to, these are the steps that I will take, you know. He knows that no bank will loan us money to renovate this building, these three buildings. It's big money. And he asked me, what will you do, Ricardo? I said, sir, I will pray. Let me tell you, that was how many years before when we moved here? 2007, I think. 2006, we were there. We were there for about 2 years, I think. Then we moved here. That was where we've been here for over 10 years now, right? Let me tell you, I did not rely on strategy or plan. We enter in by faith. And if we have started by faith, we will finish by faith. Come on. The Lord deserves that, I think. Not me, but the Lord. Listen, for those of you who are new to this congregation, I'm telling you the story of Agape. Agape started with one lady in the Greenfield Tower. Manang Remy. You know Greenfield Tower, right? Is it Greenfell or Fell Green? That's how it started. Now we have reached out to the nations. Some of you are out there already. And they will ask me, what strategy did you follow? Did you write it? Could you write your strategy so others could follow? I only say to them, I just pray. In the Philippines, what do? I just pray. I wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning to be in church, in the Presbyterian church in Clark Airways. I pray. What did we do here to occupy this three building? We prayed. And let me tell you, there's no other way to sustain this work but by prayer. We cannot rely on strategies. We cannot rely on thinking this, this, and this. We don't rely on people. Mr. Ashley is asking me, do you have kind of our landlord? I think he's watching right now because he said he's watching now. I don't know if we are on air right now. Are we on air? Hello, Mr. Ashley. He said he's watching you here now. And he's teaching, he's trying to tell me, when you preach, you know, sometimes you divert, tell some jokes so that people will be, will not fall asleep. Hello, Mr. Ashley, I hope you're not falling asleep. I said, that's not really the way we do it. I said, we rely on the Holy Spirit. We are not speakers we are not professional speakers here. We are speaking for the Lord. And so, there you go, Mr. Ashley. If you're watching, the only strategy we have is prayer. Let me tell you, I don't know what situation you are in. He was asking me, do you have people in your church who are maybe who have means? When he said means, they have. I said, we don't really have millionaires in our congregation. We are just regular workers. But let me tell you, I told him, we don't rely on people. We rely on God. And I just told him just this week when I had the meeting, I said, how will you do this now? You know, your school, something happened now. We have a big challenge with the school right now. Okay? We have lesser enrollees. And so our budget is really below, you know, and to pay our rent. But I told him, I told you, sir, from the very beginning, if this work is not from the Lord, it's not of the Lord, I don't want to have any part of this. But I assure you, sir, this is the work of the Lord. And I believe the Lord who started it, he will complete it. Listen, our God who started a good work in us, he will complete. He does not abandon. He does not abort. He is a good God. His track record, if he started a good work in you, he will complete you. He will not leave us half complete. Are you still there? So God's past faithfulness proves his everlasting dependability. Did you get that? God's past faithfulness proves his everlasting dependability. So, you know, the problem with the people of Israel is this. Okay, they want to strategize. So when they see the giants, when they see the walls, you know what happened? They become afraid. Sometimes when we look at life, are you still here? When we look at the situation happening in the world, when you hear the news, when you see the interest rate going up right now, right? The Bank of England has raised it. Oh, your mortgage payment will increase, and so you're afraid. What will I do now? Or maybe what do they do in your job? They're beginning to cut, remove workers, and then you're afraid, what if I lose my job? You'll be made redundant. You say, what will I do now if I lose my job? I get the scar. I have to pay this. Listen! God is in control. You know what Joseph said? If God delights in us, he will fight for us. We don't rely on the Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own
understanding. But in all your ways, acknowledge Him and He will what? Direct us. Listen. Even though what's happening around us, don't look on those things. Are you with me? When we look at the difficulties rather than God, listen, don't look on the difficulties, on the bigness of your difficulties or your problem or your situation. Look on the bigness of our God. Our God is bigger. Hallelujah. Our God is bigger. They saw the giants. They saw the size of the giants. But let me tell you, the size of our God is bigger than any giant. Are you still there? They saw the greatness of the walls. But let me tell you, our God is greater than any high walls. Our God is bigger. Say it with me, our God is bigger. Greater is the Lord who is in us. 1 John 4:4. We need faith. Are you with me? We need faith. 2 weeks ago, my secretary in the Philippines, Jenna, called me at 4:15 in the afternoon. We will have class at 6 o'clock, our Bible class, because we have a Bible school in the Philippines, and I'm teaching our team. He said, Pastor, pray for my grandma, because I've been calling her and she does not answer. And, you know, our driver went there and she's not answering. So our driver went in at the back and he saw blood on the floor. And so the driver went out. And so what do we do, Pastor? You know, as pastor, okay, I said, let us pray. That's the first. And so we prayed. And then I went to the church and she was there. And we talked. I talked to the Korean pastor and said, that's unusual and it's not normal. He said, why don't you go there and check on the house? So we went there. We went to the house. And the barangay. In the Philippines, there's local authority, like in every barrio. They don't want me to come in. They said they called the police already. And so I waited for... I said, how long did you call the police? 30 minutes ago, I said. So I waited for... I arrived there at 5:15 in the house. By 6:30, no police are coming. And so I said to Jenna, let's get in. And with my iPhone, with the flashlight, I went in. I turned on the lights. I saw the blood all over. And then I went to... There's blood all over. You know what happened? The grandmother was murdered. And I was the first one who saw it. 16 stab. And one of the uncle came when I saw. He's a doctor. I gave my phone and I said to Jenna, Jenna, you don't need to see this. I took her out immediately. And what will you say to a 19-year-old? Oh, just less than a year Christian, this thing happened to her grandma. You know what I said to her? Jenna, you need faith right now. Despite of what happened, you need to have faith in God, that God knows this. He said, why did God allow this? People will say, why did God allow that? I have no answer. But I just know, when something like this happened in our lives, God can do something greater. We just have to trust Him. Maybe you are in a crisis right now. Maybe you don't know what to do. Listen, our God is greater still. Amen? So the scripture declares this. Don't get your eyes off God. The Bible tells us, turn your eyes upon Jesus. When things are not happening the way you like, to whom shall we look into? To Jesus. Amen? The scriptures declare that God will keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on Him. So, you know, after hearing the report of the spies, two of them made a good report, 10 made bad report, what did they decide? Do you know what did they decide? In Numbers 14:4, they want to select a leader and return to Egypt. That's what they want to do. And then on verse 9, they want to stone Joshua and Caleb for bringing and say, let's go, let's occupy, let's move forward. Instead of believing, you know, in faith, the two good reporters, they choose to believe the majority. And you know what? The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 3, because of this, you know, because of unbelief, they were not able to enter the promised land. Are you with me? Okay, to make the story, just to tell you the story is this. The Lord said, none of those who went out of Egypt 20 years old above will not be able to enter. And as a result, instead, they're about to enter 40 years after. They have not yet entered the promised land. A whole generation has to be, you know, to pass away first. And those children that they're worried about, they said, what will happen to our children now? Sometimes we are like this. If we die, what will happen to my children? Hello, are you still with me here? We want to take care of the future. It's good. We prepare for the future. But let me tell you, only God can really take care of the future. And so, that's why we need faith. The same thing I said to Jenna, if you are in a crisis right now, we need faith. There are a few contrasts here that I've written about faith and unbelief. Faith will give us comfort in the midst of fears. Unbelief will give you fear in the midst of your comfort. Hello, are you still there? Faith makes great burdens light. Unbelief makes light burdens heavy. Faith lifts us when we are down. Unbelief puts us down when we are up. Faith brings us near to God when we are far from Him. Unbelief puts us far from God when we are near Him. Faith purifies our hearts. Unbelief pollutes our hearts. Are you still there? Faith brings peace to the troubled soul. Unbelief brings turmoil to the peaceful soul. Faith causes us to rejoice in the midst of sorrows. Unbelief causes us to mourn in the midst of blessing. So this morning, where do we go from here? Shall we follow their unbelief? Or shall we walk by faith? We need faith to carry on living this Christian life. We are facing a troubled times ahead. Listen po. We are facing troubled times ahead. In the last days, there will be perilous times. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Men will be lovers of self, lovers of money, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Are you still there? Lovers of the world rather than lovers of the Lord. I would say what will keep us, sustain us in these times, in these troubled times, is faith in the Lord. God's track record. Hello, are you still there? God's faithfulness. Let me see, repeat this to you. God's faithfulness, past faithfulness, proves His everlasting dependability. Can I depend on God? You make a choice. Can we depend on people? Can we depend on our job? Can we depend on, you know, the things of the world? None. All these things are just temporal. I call us this morning. Look at God's track record.
That is our source of what? Dependability and reliability. He is faithful. Stand with me right now. The people of Israel were not able to. The promised land speak of rest. I don't know, maybe some of us here are struggling. You're in a trial. Something happened in your life you don't understand. But I call us to have faith in God. He's faithful. He will carry us through. Amen. Praise God. Do you know that song? In his, he has been faithful, faithful to me. Can we sing that? Just close your eyes for a while and talk to the Lord in your own way. I don't know what the challenge that is ahead of you. Instead of being anxious, instead of panicking, why don't you just cast it unto the Lord right now? Your future, your plan, your ambition. I've heard this saying, we may not know what the future holds, as long we know who holds our future. How many people you know who holds your future? As for me, I may not know what will happen tomorrow or next month. I know God is in control. Amen. He's been faithful. He's been faithful. Faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercies I see.
There are times
I have questioned, even failed to believe, but He's been faithful, faithful to me. Is this your song as well? Sing it with me now. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Oh, looking back. His love and mercies I see. In my heart I have questioned and been failed to believe, but He's been faithful, faithful to me. Isn't this true? There are times in my life I have, why, Lord? But let me tell you, throughout the years that I have chosen to walk with the Lord, He does not explain immediately. But throughout the years, I look back. I stand before you today. He is faithful. He will never fail you. He never failed me, and He won't start now. Listen, He will not fail us. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changed. Come on, sing it one more time. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back. His love and mercies I see. And in my heart, I have questions, even failed to believe, but He's been faithful, faithful to me. Let us pray. Lord, I pray for us this morning, especially for those who are despondent, Lord. They're losing hope. They're distressed. They don't know what the future holds for them. But this morning, we make a choice to believe, to trust you, to rely on your track record. You are a good God. You are a great God. You are a generous God. You are a gracious God. So Lord, this morning, open our eyes that we may see. That we may not see the bigness of our problem, but we will see the bigness of our God. We will not see the greatness of the walls that we're facing, but we will see the greatness of our God, that He's able to carry us when we can't carry on. Holy Spirit, I ask, reveal Jesus to us afresh this morning. Refocus us, refresh us. And may we rely on your past faithfulness that proves your eternal dependability. I only depend on you, Lord. Come on, tell the Lord, I only depend on you, Lord. Jesus. And we say amen.
Hi everyone, my name is Jereen. Welcome to Agape and thank you so much for joining us today. There's actually so many things going on in this church, so please stay tuned for the following announcements.
Hey, if you want to give it to our church, here's four ways that you can give. It's sight, a light, feel, and ultimate. Visit our website.
Have a great week, and I'll see you soon.